Hello everyone, my name is Mukesh Sharma and today we are going to continue Plato from where we left it yesterday. And before we start studying Plato, I would like to add a few things. Based on your feedback, I would like to add a little bit of Hindi as well. And although I am not willing to do that, but yet I would like to do so, because if my subscriber or my friends are not able to fully grasp what I'm teaching, then my teaching is of no value. So I'll be adding a little bit of Hindi in it as well, but where it is most urgently or most necessarily needed, not otherwise. And now we're going to study Plato, but before we do that, we will have a look at what we studied yesterday. Plato was master of Aristotle. And he was a Greek philosopher. I would not call him a Greek critic, I would rather call him Greek philosopher. And his most important works are the Dialogues, Ion, Lysis, Symposium, Georgics, Phaedrus, and Republic. These are some of his important works. And we also saw that his critical views on literature are largely found in his two works, Ion and Republic. Okay. Now, what we studied the most important thing yesterday was his theory of forms or ideas. Okay, he considers forms or ideas as the primary thing or original thing. All other physical objects which we see in this world are secondary. They are actually the copies of the forms or the ideas that we have in our minds. Okay, so he also calls literature as twice removed from reality. Okay, he gives us a theory of mimesis or imitation. Okay, he says that when a poet imitates a physical object, that physical object is actually a copy of an idea. So because the physical object is the copy of an idea, it is already removed from reality. Okay, once removed from reality. And when a poet or an artist copies a physical object into his work of art, he is actually copying a copy. So the work of art, in particular literature, is going to be twice removed from that reality. Okay, so from what we have seen so far, we can say that in the ideal state of Plato, poetry is not going to find any place, because he does not consider poetry to be a good thing or a positive influence on the people. Okay, so we are going to continue our work, our study from poetry in Plato's Republic. Now, we are going to see what place does the poetry have in the ideal state of Plato. Okay, now Plato's theory of poetry in the Republic is much less flattering. His main concern is in this text is to define justice and ideal nature of a political state. Now, most often you will find, especially in Plato, the things that are not directly related to literature, like I am talking about ideal nature of a political state. You might think that, what is this? We are studying literature here. We are studying criticism here. Why we have to study the ideal nature of a political state? But we have to study because this is related to his theory of poetry. Now, what actually Plato has to say? He says that poetry and philosophy. Okay. Poetry and philosophy have no competition whatsoever, and philosophy is much higher than poetry. Means poetry cannot compete with philosophy. Hai na? But Plato says that poetry is a very powerful force in changing or molding the public opinion. Hai na? And it is a kind of danger to his ideal city. बिकॉज पोइट्री हैज दिस पावर कि ये लोगों की ओपिनियन को बदल सकती है. इट इज़ वेरी डेंजरस. ओके, वाई इज इट डेंजरस? ही एक्सप्लेन्स इट फर्दर. ही सेज दैट एनी स्टेट और एनी आइडियल स्टेट हैज अ काइंड ऑफ स्ट्रिक्ट हायरार्की, है ना, वेयर बाय द गार्डियंस विच आर फिलोसफर्स and their helpers, of course their soldiers, they are a kind of minority, thode se log hain, which rule over a large majority of farmers, craftsmen and money makers, means businessmen. Now इन सब पे रूल करने का काम जो है वो थोड़े से लोगों का है. नाउ ये फंक्शन, दीज फंक्शंस वुड गो ऑन प्रॉपरली इफ एवरीवन इज परफॉर्मिंग हिज टास्क प्रॉपरली, और वी कैन से द टास्क गिवन टू अ पर्सन प्रॉपरली. एंड प्लेटो थिंक्स दैट एवरी पर्सन शुड हैव वन टास्क असाइन टू हिम अकॉर्डिंग टू हिज कैपेबिलिटी और अबिलिटी. So Plato is in favor of giving everybody only one task, okay, जिसमें वो perfect हो, केवल एक task. But Plato says that poets are multifaceted persons. They can write on whatever subject they want. Means they are not like other workers who have only one task to perform or one kind of task to perform, which is necessary for maintaining the hierarchy or which is necessary to maintain the the peace in the ideal state. Now poets, as they can do multiple tasks, as they can write whatever they want, they disrupt or they disturb this hierarchy, so they are a kind of danger, okay, to the ideal city. Now Plato advocates an open and strict censorship of poetry on the grounds of, there are three grounds on which Plato wants to censor the poetry. First one is the falsity of its claims and representations regarding both gods and men. Now we are going to have a discussion on this particular point when we will study Aristotle in detail, but for the time being I'll tell you what this means. Plato says that the claims made by poetry are false, okay, and it represents gods and men in a false light as well. He actually takes the example of Homer, Aeschylus and other tragedy writers, where gods are presented as mean, as doing bad things or mischievous things, so he doesn't see them fit for a common man to see them, okay. So according to him, poetry, as we have already seen, it is twice removed from reality, it is far away from reality, it presents falsity, okay. Secondly, its corruptive effect on character. So it corrupts people. Why? Because it shows vices to be rewarded and it shows virtues to be not rewarded, or virtues are not actually rewarded in tragedy, because the central character has to die. Please don't see it in the light of the tragedies that we have read, in which the people die, and we have logic as well that why those people die, okay. Hum jo hai usko modern day light mein nahi dekhenge, we are going to see it in lines of what Plato sees it to be. To ye corrupt karti hai character ko, okay. Its disorderly complexity and encouragement of individualism in the sphere of sensibility and feeling. Now, Plato thinks that in the era of states being the superior powers, individualism is dangerous, and the poetry or literature is not only complex but also encourages individualism. So because a poet can write anything, the poet can make anything, okay, so he can make a god bad, he can make a vicious person good, according to Plato. So this is something really bad which should not happen. So he actually demands a censorship of poetry, okay. Next he says that the problem with poetry is that it appeals to the inferior part of our soul, while philosophy appeals to the superior part of our soul. Means it brings out poetry, especially it brings out the things that are inferior, okay, when compared to the things brought out by philosophy, okay. And poetry also encourages variety and multiplicity. Okay, and it also values toward values the particular for its own sake, thereby distracting from contemplation on of the universal. Means ये जो poetry है ये universal पर ध्यान ना केंद्रित करके it actually values individualism, it values multiplicity, and multiplicity is something really bad for an ideal state, because in ideal state there should be simplicity, there should be every person working the given task or working on the given task that I have already told you. So these things make poetry something really bad as far as Plato's opinion is concerned. So as you can see in this slide, the things that I already told you, that in an ideal state justice is a condition where each one man must perform one social service in the state for which his nature was best adapted. Predictably, justice in an individual is defined as a condition of the soul where the several parts perform each their own task and where reason rules. Now, when everybody will be performing the tasks given to them, reason will prevail, logic will prevail. But poetry, as I have already told you, is written when there is no reason, when a poet is inspired by the goddess Muse. He leaves logic behind and writes in a kind of divine frenzy. Okay, so there can be no expectation of justice if poets are going to live in a state. Okay, here you can see Plato clearly states that poetry's greatest crime is its refusal or inability to confine itself to one kind of task. Poetry cannot be confined to one kind of task. This is the greatest crime of poetry. Now, Plato urges that the same man ought not to be imitated many things, and a poet does so. Any poetic imitation involving manifold forms will, says Socrates, Socrates नहीं कह रहा है, ये Plato ही कह रहा है, be ill suited to our quality, because there is no twofold or manifold man among us, since every man does one thing. So these views might seem to you very simple, but Plato is thinking according to his own times. Okay, one man should do only one task, and a poet is not confined to one task, so poet should be banished. Okay, pretty simple, but not that simple. Now in this slide, you'll have to read it word by word or word for word. Now see, because these lines are very important, and they can be asked in exam. So Plato then arrives at the renowned passage urging banishment of the manifold poet. He says that if a man who was capable by his cleverness of assuming every kind of shape and imitating all things should arrive in our city, agar koi poet hamare city mein aa gaya, bringing with himself the poems which he wished to exhibit, we should fall down and worship him. Now see, he is actually saying the people to fall down in front of him and worship him as a holy and wondrous and delightful creature, but should say to him that there is no man of that kind among us in our city, nor is it lawful for such a man to arise among us, and we should send him away to another city. Now see, what Plato has to say, he says ki hame aise aadmi ka samman karna chahiye, but use we should send him to another city, we should banish that particular kind of man from the ideal state or our state. You can read the rest of the part after pausing the video. So the last one, he says a poet is a truly clever and wondrous man who makes all the things that all handicraftsmen severally produce. जो बहुत सारे हैंडीक्राफ्ट्समैन मिलके बनाते हैं वो एक अकेला पोइट बना देता है अपनी पोइट्री में. सो ही हैज़ नो प्लेस बिकॉज ही इज गोइंग टू डिस्टर्ब द हायरार्की, ही इज गोइंग टू डिस्टर्ब द ऑर्डर ऑफ द आइडियल स्टेट. Now in this slide, Plato compares poetry with democracy. Remember, democracy is not or was not considered to be a good thing then. It was, you know, a kind of so monarchy was there and democracy was not favored. So he compares democracy with poetry and says that both foster genuine individuals, manifold men who are stuck with differences and resist the reduction of their social function or indeed their natural potential into one exclusive dimension. He is repeating one thing, that a person should be, you know, restricted to only one field of work or one task, one kind of task, and whoever is not, you know, limited to one doing one task is not a good man. Okay. Also, like democracy, poetry nurses all parts of the soul, refusing obeisance to law of reason. Poetry or and democracy both refuse to go by the reason. By implication, then poetry itself is spurred by the greed for liberty, which is the hallmark of democratic society. Now, poetry and democracy both have this greed for liberty, which is not a good thing for a monarchy. Okay, so that is why poetry, like democracy, is a bad thing. So to sum it up, we can say that the Plato's indictment of poetry or Plato's criticism of poetry has been based on these five things. One is its interesting intrinsic expression of falsehood. Okay, so it, you know, favors falsehood. It spreads falsehood because it is twice removed from reality. Its intrinsic operation in the realm of imitation, because it imitates, it is bad. Okay, and while imitating it, a poet is frenzied and he is divinely inspired. He is out of his reason, so he is a bad person and poetry is a bad thing. Its combination of a variety of functions, which is a bad thing, I've told you many times, that har kisi ko ek kaam milna chahiye aur use wahi kaam karna chahiye, na ki bahut sare kaam. Its appeal to the lower aspects of the soul, such as emotion and appetite. It appeals to the inferior aspects of the soul, emotions. Emotions to hone nahi chahiye. Emotions honge to ek democracy jarur chalegi, lekin ek monarchy nahi chalegi. What will happen if soldiers, you know, refuse to fight for the country because they are emotional towards their family? Its expression of irreducible multiplicity rather than unity. Now he is continuously favoring unity in favor of multiplicity. He does not favor multiplicity, sorry. So these are the five reasons he attacks or criticizes poetry. So these are a few things that you need to remember when you study Plato. I would sum up the things by telling you a few basic points that you need to remember. You need to remember that Plato's critical views on literature are largely found in his two works, Aeon and Republic. Plato's Republic is a seminal work in literary criticism, and according to Plato, art is an imitation of an imitation. Mimesis word yaad rakhna aap log. So art is an imitation by man, and this is an imitation of an idea, or rather we can say this is an imitation of a physical object, which is an imitation of an idea. Dimag mein ek idea aayega, uska imitation, uski copy hogi, wo ek physical object hoga. Table ka example kal humne dekha tha. And then a poet or an artist, when he copies that particular table into his work, this imitation will be thrice or twice removed from the reality. You must also remember that he says that the poet should be banished from the ideal state. Okay, one thing that is not covered in these slides, and it's not that long, I'll tell you orally, that only one kind of poetry is suitable or good according to Plato. Any poetry which is spiritual, or any poetry which is written in praise of great heroes, is good for the spiritual growth. and a state as well. Now, he says that philosophy is the primary thing and art is the secondary. And he also says that the truth is the end of imitation. The end or the goal of imitation should be truth and not pleasure. Pleasure should not be the goal of imitation. There are a few writers who praised Plato, like Sir Philip Sidney praised him and said, of all philosophers, he is the most poetical, and of all the poets, he is the most philosophical. Shelley also praised him, saying, Plato exhibits the rare union of subtle logic with enthusiasm of poetry. Okay, he says the logic plus poetry is equal to Plato. So these were a few things, and those who are on my Telegram group, we are going to have a test very soon on Plato. So be ready for the test, and please do subscribe to my channel. It gives me motivation to make more videos. And if you cannot share, if you don't have time, you can at least subscribe to my channel. Thank you. Thank you very much.